basketball. I know that's something that people definitely like, and we had four good games tonight. So, well, who knows? Maybe we'll pick your brain about how they turned out. So, anything.
Okay.
You know me, Tom. Anything's possible, right, partner?
My pleasure. Sounds good.
All right. Thank you, Tom. Appreciate it. Have a good night, and we'll do it in less than 48 hours. All right. Well, around 48 hours, because you stay a little bit later. We cater to please late. Okay, Tommy?
Well, I'll be there.
All right. Thank you, Tom. Have a good night. Appreciate
Take care.
You.
Okay.
But meanwhile, our next guest is the legendary Bucky Waters. And since you're a baseball guy, okay, the one thing about Bucky Waters, and we're not going to have time to bring it up to him, is he actually did go ahead and receive a humanitarian award in March of 2005. It was the Lou Gehrig Catfish Hunter Award for his humanitarian efforts. So.
Right, and yeah, both of those guys obviously passed away due to complications of ALS.
Right, right.
So,
but, you know, we won't have time to get into it, but I'm glad that we were able to bring it up to him for sure.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be cool talking to a guy who's got, you know, 6+ decades in the game the way he does. I mean, he started out as a player with NC State in the late 50s, and look where he is now, obviously one of the
84 next month.
Yeah, I mean, the guy is, you know, birthday December 17th for anybody who doesn't know that. So,
right.
I mean, this guy, he's a basketball lifer the way that a lot of the other people that we talk to are lifers in their own respective sports that they cover and they love. So it's going to be fun to talk to him. I always love meeting people like that, especially we got to, I mean, for those of you who listen and read, you know, our podcast and our articles in South Florida Tribune, we got the opportunity to speak to Gene Deckerhoff. So if you get a chance, go on our podcasting center and check that out. Scott did a really nice interview with him last Thursday. You know, they talked football, you know, FSU, Jaguars, everything. It was a nice, you know, nice interview with one of the more respected and lauded names in college sports broadcasting, even professional sports. I mean, the guy did 500 games in both FSU football and Jacksonville football. So, I mean, like, it's pretty incredible what he's done in his, you know, 4 or 5 decades plus and, you know, these games.
So yeah, well, I belong to the National Sports Media Association, Lewis, and I had an opportunity to go up there last June for the awards banquet and all that. So it was really kind of neat to be able to do that, make the contacts that you'll find out as time goes on. And now, speaking of Bucky Waters, and we'll bring on Bucky right now. And Bucky Waters, we want to thank you to the Sports Exchange. Thanks for being with us, Bucky.
I'm looking forward to it. Did you watch that Kentucky or Duke Kansas game?
Did I? No, I leave it to guys like you to do it because I'm out there broadcasting to lots of people so they can hear everybody here. But
well, I did 20 years in the garden doing game. I got goose pimples just watching it tonight. Wow. Are we ready to go?
Let's go.
Let's do it. So let's lead off with the Duke game, and we have a myriad of other things we want to talk. And Bucky, just so you know, I'm introducing to Lewis Eddie Weiss, my young co-host.
How's it going? Nice to meet you, Bucky.
Good evening, Lewis. You're a bright young star, I am told. That's what my scouting report said. Are you ready for this?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's go. Let's talk some hoops.
I'm 83 years old. You may have to carry me over to finish line.
Yeah, I'll do what I got to do. I mean, we'll get this train rolling, so let's get going.
Okay. Hey,
I got news for you. Like I was telling Lewis before you called, Buck, how much fun that you and I had getting to know each other out in North Carolina, out Winston-Salem. It was really cool stuff.
Thank you. Let me caution you guys. The reason I stopped doing games was my ear in 2017. My hearing went. That goes with age and all those noisy arenas for all those almost 40 years of broadcasting. So please tonight speak loud and speak slow so that I understand your questions or the conversation.
Absolutely.
No problem. We're with you. So with that said, why don't you give us your overall synopsis of the Duke game tonight?
Oh, my goodness. It was Duke is they're young. I call it Coach K's kinder care because with this one and done thing, every year he's starting 3 and 4 freshmen. And to start the season with a team that young against a veteran Kansas team that was very, very physical, I was amazed with the way they stood up to it. What was amazing about tonight's game, Kansas had 28 turnovers with a veteran team. I mean, I know about garden jitters, having done the games up there for years. I can't explain what happened because this is a very, very good Kansas team. But those turnovers killed them.
Okay, let's go on to the fact that college basketball starting earlier than it has. We're talking about the first week of November. There was a time when it started later November and then into December. You know, what are your thoughts about the fact that they keep moving it up? I think it's at some point you can only move it up so much. It's not like you're talking the NBA where you put it in October.
Yeah, well, there's one simple rule to all of those questions, and that is follow the money. Why are they doing it? Because it gets airtime, it sells commercials, and they're increasing the number of games. So in order to increase the number of games and keep these kids from trying to go to college and play three nights a week, they had to expand the season. But it's clearly driven by money. College basketball, college football are hot, and they're gonna ride it hard. Now, you guys are in Florida. Did I hear this right? That Florida State fired the coach midseason, and the buyout for him was $17 million.
You heard it right, mm-hmm. Bucky. Yep, they did.
Oh, give me $17 million to go away. Okay, I'll do that.
No but coaches meetings.
Yeah, but that just shows the example. The and we'll get to this. I know you mentioned you wanted to go there, but the college kids get room, board, tuition, and $15 a month, and the coaches are making millions. Everybody's making millions, and they're finally recognizing that. Hey, you know what? There may be an inequity here. I hope so.
Yeah, I mean, that $17 million to go away, I think Willie Taggart will be okay for a couple of years, and I think he subsequently gets another opportunity for sure. So let's talk about paying of the athlete. You have the big sports versus the smaller sports. I know we talked about that during our pre-production conversation earlier today. And I know you're for it, but go ahead and give us your perspectives on that.
Okay, well, there's really two sides to this. One is the schools should pay the athletes. That's a question, and I think they certainly should increase the payment to the athletes who are working hard. You can't believe how hard these kids work. And I'm not talking about football and basketball. I'm talking about wrestlers, lacrosse players, tennis players, swimmers. They're all, you know, really putting a lot into what they do. And it's good personally, yes. And they got a scholarship, and that's great. But I'd like to see a little spread from the university, increase that cushion, because I can tell you from coaching, head coaching at Duke and at West Virginia, that some of those kids, just with a scholarship from where they come from, don't have enough to go out and buy a pizza and day to day. It's just hello.
Yeah, I'm here. We're here.
Oh, I heard a wild noise. I didn't. Okay, but. So that's one case. But the other is Zion Williamson, who just recently left Duke after 1 year, a one and done. I mean, you could put his face and name on a jersey, as exciting as he was, sell millions of them. He would get nothing. And that's wrong. That's not right. So the difference is, if it's an individual thing from private enterprise, you shouldn't stand in the way if they're deserving. That's my opinion. So take it and run with it, Lewis.
Yeah, Bucky, I had a question I wanted to ask, because I posed this to somebody a couple of weeks ago. I believe it was Shanahan, or it may have been former NFL player now involved in the sport, Mel Farr Jr. I asked him, and Scott concurred with me, don't you think this is going to further the divide, given that, you know, certain schools have more money than others? Obviously, a D1 team like Alabama will have more money than, say, you know, like where a second division school where Aaron Rodgers went, I believe, went to Cal. Don't you think that's going to further the divide when teams are recruiting, you know, high school athletes to these teams, given the financial wherewithal that they have?
Well, I, if I'm understanding your question right, you're saying that there is no limit to what the schools can do, and they can outbid other schools. I was thinking more of a flat great. You know, instead of $15 a month, if you give them a scholarship, you give them, with that comes $3,000 a year or $5,000 a year. Not, can you top this between Clemson and Alabama? Although we know over time there have been in recruiting battles that kind of competition, unfortunately, has existed. But no, I'm talking about a moderate flat fee for a college athlete to be able to enjoy life. I will tell you, I have reached in my pocket as a coach to give a player money to go to be with a grandfather that was dying that he couldn't afford and the family couldn't afford. And so it's not about making them rich. It's about a little cushion for these athletes to stop living like Spartans when there are millions and millions of dollars flowing all around them. I'm saying let's share a little here.
Yeah, I agree with you, Bucky. I mean, when you talk about, for example, schools like, for example, Florida Atlantic University in Boca, and then you compare it with the Alabamas or LSUs or whatever, there's such a big disparity when it comes to what the likeness is and the compensation would be when you're dealing with those particular type of schools, isn't there?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think it, wherever the kid signs, what are we calling it? The scholarship should be the same. If he goes to Florida State or Notre Dame or Florida Atlantic, with his scholarship, the max should be $1,500, $2,000, $3,000, whatever it is. It should not be competitive in that era. The only time I can see the wide open big dollars is private enterprise to individuals whose talent, name, reputation earn it. They're entitled. Remember when Olympics were amateurs only? Oh, yeah. Are you old enough to remember that? And now there isn't an amateur in the Olympics. Well, maybe a few sports, but that's time. That's greed to a degree. That's enterprise. And so finally, these great athletes are able to make some money while their bodies are able to do it, and they shouldn't be restricted. Okay, that's enough said, unless you want to take it further.
Well, I mean, I guess, yeah, you're right on target there. I think the one thing we're all referring to is the haves and the have-nots is what we're talking about, because there's other sports to me that deserve the same type of thing. The question I have for you is this, okay? California passed a law that started this whole thing. Florida's going to do it, and other states are going to do it. Is the NCAA version of what they're going to do going to be comparable to what some of the individual states' legislation is going to be about?
Well, there are two things involved here in the future. One is money, and two is courts. What is an individual right? All of that's going to come into it, and the NCAA is a very in trying to put their arms around this multi-billion-dollar machine, television. It's not capable of handling it. It's making little decisions. Like, we had an incident here with the University of North Carolina that had an 18-year fiasco in an academic area that they never went to class, and they got great grades and all, and the NCAA could not get involved because they were not permitted to get involved in academic questions. So it's a bunch of academicians, bright people, caring people, but they're not armed to go after the questions that are arising today. I'd love to see Jay Billis hit the NCAA. Somebody like that that's strong. And right now it's a sort of a little political thing, and the money is just running over them.
Okay. Bucky, let's talk about the one-and-done concept. What are your thoughts about that?
I'm sorry, repeat, please.
Sure. What are your thoughts about the one-and-done concept?
Well, it's there again, different sides. I am very aware of kids that come to college and everybody wants them to stay. Oh, please stay another year. Please stay another year. And if they stay another year and have that knee injury of all time, They've blown a lifetime. The one and done is going to change, I believe.